Chapter 1, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show the servants things which must shortly come to pass. That was written in the first century, folks. Verse 3, blessed is he that reads, and they that hear the words of the prophecy, of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. And then if you go to the last chapter, that's in the first chapter. If you go to the last chapter of Revelation, listen to this. It says here in verse 6 of chapter 22, and he said to me, these sayings are faithful and true, and the Lord God of the holy prophets sent his angel to show unto his servants the things which must shortly be done. Again, that was written 2,000 years ago. Verse 7, Jesus says, behold, I come quickly. All right? He says in verse 10 of Revelation 22, and he said to me, don't seal the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand. Verse 12, behold, I come quickly. And then finally, in verse 20, he which testifies these things says, surely I come quickly. And John says, amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The book of Revelation, simply put, was said to take place in the first century. Quickly. Behold, I come quickly. These are the things which must shortly come to pass. Not 2,000 years later. In fact, all of the apostles believed it was happening in their lifetime. The writer of Hebrews said this, yet a very, very little while, and he that is coming will come and will not tarry. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 36. Peter said, the end of all things is at hand. In 1 Peter, I believe it's chapter 4, verse 7. The disciples even asked Jesus, when Jesus said, look, the temple is going to be destroyed, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. They said, tell us, Master, when shall these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming in the end of the age? Jesus goes on to say, the gospel is going to be preached in all the world, which it was, Romans 10, verses 17 and 18, Colossians chapter 1, verses 4 through 6, and verse 23, all teach that the gospel was preached back then to the entire world and to every creature, just like Jesus commanded, okay? And Jesus preached there would be many antichrists. Well, 1 John says, little children, it is the last hour, and as you have heard that antichrist shall come, even so now are there many antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last hour. And that's what Jesus predicted. Okay? All that happened in the first century. So the disciples asked, tell us, Master, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse, or chapter 10. It's Paul said that they were in the end of the age. Hebrews chapter 9, the writer says they in the first century were in the end of the age. Okay? Bible says, now once in the end of the age, Christ appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. So Jesus taught it was going to happen back then, and so did the New Testament writers, including John. Jesus said, when you disciples, see all these things, all these signs, know that it is near, even at the doors. Well, James was one of the guys that was there, and he said, grudge not one against another, brethren, for behold, the judge stands at the door. Okay, so they all believed that it was going to happen back then, and it did. Really, what they were talking about was the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. It wasn't an issue about a cataclysmic catastrophe that was going to come on all of planet Earth. It had to do with Jerusalem. That's what the Bible was about. It was about God's dealings with Jerusalem. And through Jesus Christ, salvation has come to the Gentiles. We're in a new and everlasting covenant, and the earth is going to remain forever. You say, no, this guy's off his rocker. I can prove it biblically. The Bible says, unto us a son is given, unto us a child is born. The government shall be upon his shoulders. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end. Ecclesiastes says, one generation comes and another goes, but the earth remains forever. The Bible says that the gates of the city are always open so that people may enter into that city. What did Jesus call the church? He said, you are a city set up on a hill. So that's what the Bible's about. People continually believe in Jesus Christ, enter into the gates of the city. It's not a future city. The city is the church. It's you and me, loving Jesus Christ and loving one another. So let's get rid of all of these false prophecies and be able to prove it biblically, why they are junk. It's bogus. And so I encourage all of you to rethink this. Don't get caught up in it. You know, what happens to people is they start believing, well, if 2012 is the time, December 21st, 2012, according to the Mayan calendar, well, what do they start doing? Evangelicals get caught up in this stuff. They start putting stuff on credit cards. They go into debt. They buy all of these luxurious items thinking, hey, guess what? It's all going to burn anyway. Let's kill every tree. Let's chop down trees. Let's drill into every place we can and try and find oil and pollute the atmosphere. Let's just damage the earth because it's all going to be destroyed anyway. What a futile mindset. That's terrible. It's careless, reckless thinking. And guess what? Instead of giving thanks to God for the beautiful forest that He's provided and the beautiful atmosphere, the sky, the clouds, the rain, all the wonderful, beautiful things that He has given to us, we're busy destroying it because we don't think planet Earth has a chance in hell. Okay? So instead of putting all your money onto, or all of your stuff onto a credit card, going into massive debt, and then having 2012 come and go, you get depressed, you go and blow the brains out of your family, and then blow your own brains out, why don't you make a rational decision? Why don't you believe the Bible for what it says? Jesus said this, "Assuredly I say to you, the Son of Man will come in the glory of His Father with all His holy angels, and shall reward every man according to his works. Guaranteed, I say unto you," is what He said, "there are some standing here who will not die until they see the Son of Man coming in His kingdom." Coming in His kingdom. He wasn't talking about the transfiguration. He wasn't talking about the resurrection or His ascension. He was talking about His coming in His kingdom. Okay? So there was the reward. And that's what happened. God destroyed Pharisaic Israel, the self-righteous. God always destroys the self-righteous. Okay, and unfortunately, that's where modern evangelicalism is. They're exactly like the Pharisees of old. They're filled with self-righteousness. They're pointing the finger as if other people are worse than they are, when they are in fact doing the same things. All you got to do is look at all of the scandals on the Christian broadcasting networks. Okay, that's the problem, is self-righteousness. And we hope for a physical dominion, physical conquering. Let's just destroy this world and get it over with. When Jesus said this, "My kingdom is within you." It's when Christ dwells in our hearts that we're filled with the love of God and we stop judging one another. We stop acting as if people are worse than we are, and we start exercising a little bit more compassion. Get our troops out of Afghanistan. Get our troops out of Iraq. Stop making Muslims mad at us. And stop slaughtering Palestinians. And instead, why don't we start showing the love of Christ toward Muslims? Maybe they may want to take a second look at Christianity if we started loving them rather than killing them. Christians, stop pouring money into Israel. Stop supporting the U.S. slaughter of Palestinians through the Israelites. It's wrong, and it's anti-gospel. It's anti-Christ. And it's a doctrine that was formulated by evangelicals. Okay? So let's just stop it. Stop the false prophecies. Let's get back into being grateful to God for the cross of Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins, and live our lives in such a way that people can see our love and say, like Jesus, they are His disciples. We can see it by their love. Isn't that what Christ said? "They will know you're My disciples by your love for one another." I'm Ward Finley with NewCreationMinistries.tv. Rethink the way you think and start thinking more biblically. Thanks for watching. I appreciate it.